But first, in Bosnia-Herzegovina, the country's reputedly moderate ruling Islamic community is cracking down on dozens of radical mosques. The head of that community is on guard after his life was threatened by extremists. The radical mosque will be shut down unless they come under the council's control. But there are doubts whether these small, mainly rural mosques pose the greatest threat in terms of radicalization. A former Bosnian intelligence officer has told the NewsHour that Western allies should be more concerned about the risk from a huge Saudi-sponsored mosque in the capital, Sarajevo. Special correspondent Malcolm Brabant reports.
I'm in central Bosnia, about 100 miles from the capital, Sarajevo. I'm heading up to a remote mountain village called Osve, which is a place where supposedly there are some supporters of the so-called Islamic State. There have been people who've gone from this village to fight in Syria. Some have reportedly been killed. And we're going to meet somebody who used to play rock and roll, but is now labeled by the head of the Islamic community in Bosnia as someone who is a terrorist.
Izzet Hadžić used to be lead guitarist in a band called Black Lady. After fighting in the Bosnian War, he abandoned what he thought was a decadent lifestyle and sought peace in religion. He leads one of these so-called radical mosques. While he's in dispute with the Islamic establishment, he insists he's no terrorist.
Where does it come from to call us terrorists? It's because people who look like us, have these beards, are doing such acts in the world, specifically ISIS and this Cretan Baghdadi.
Two doors away from Hadžić's small holding is the father of a young man killed in Syria. Next door is a family Hadžić regards as extreme. Bosnian intelligence officers are frequent visitors. Hadžić unequivocally condemns Islamic State.
You can't call this jihad. To take a gun while someone is walking down the street with his family and begin to shoot? Can you imagine a soldier doing this? These people are equal to cowards.
We had a polite but frosty reception in Bocinja, a nearby village that was a stronghold of foreign mujahideen during the Bosnian War. We had hoped to interview a man who returned from Syria in 2014, but he didn't want to be filmed because of an impending court case. His name is Ibrahim Delic. Dozens of other Bosnians now in Syria are said to want to return because they're horrified by ISIS atrocities. Crippled and radicalized during the Bosnian War, Delic recently talked to the Balkan Investigative Reporting Network. Significantly, he criticized the Free Syrian Army, who are enemies of ISIS.
That Free Syrian Army, that is one scum army. Sometimes they picked a girl, took her, raped a girl, gave her back home, or they killed her.
The flag in this video, shot in Syria, is not that of Islamic State. Delic is telling a crowd to fight for Islam. He insists he did not commit any crimes.
When I saw that at the checkpoints they started to stop foreigners who came to fight, when I saw Free Syrian Army soldiers taking guns away from them and killing them for the gun or for the little money they had, these foreign guys started to attack back, and at that moment I knew that a big conflict among them is going to happen. I asked some people to help me get back across the border.
This poor rural village contains several Serb families, once the sworn enemies of Islamists. But subsistence farmer Milan Petrovic insists he's happy to live here.
To tell you the truth, they are our good neighbors. We have no problems. They greet us, we greet them. We don't have any problems.
To get an assessment of the risk posed by radical Islamists in Bosnia, we visited a murder scene, in truth, a mocked-up murder scene used for training students at the Department of Criminology at Sarajevo University. Professor Goran Kovacevic, a Serb, is an expert on Islamic radicals and spent 7 years as an agent with Bosnian intelligence.
They are not radicals like they are presented in medias. For example, you have in the United States Amish groups behaving in a similar manner.
The big difference is that the Amish are avowed pacifists. The radicals are total opposites, according to officials of Bosnia's Islamic community. The organization claims it's trying to preserve moderate Quranic principles practiced in Bosnia since the country was conquered by the Ottoman Empire in the 15th century. International Relations Director Razim Cholic says hardline mosques are the product of extreme foreign influence.
as the passage of time, these people got radicalized, a number of them, they have been in contact with some people outside of Bosnia and Herzegovina, because this is not from Bosnia, it has been imported from somewhere else.
Since issuing an edict effectively outlawing the radical mosques, Bosnia's Muslim spiritual leader Hussein Kavazovic, seen here at an inauguration ceremony, has required additional security.
He told that they are, when they come here, they would slaughter him in the middle of Sarajevo. So we are probably the first target because they take us as infidels.
But concerns have been raised about the huge Saudi-funded King Fahd Mosque, one of several that have changed not just Sarajevo's skyline, but also, allegedly, the way of thinking. Yet normally it's controlled by the Bosnian Islamic Community.
People should be worried about this mosque, because they'll have a lot of money. That's the most radical mosque in all Bosnia and Herzegovina, but it's under formal Islamic Community, and it's not ever mentioned as a part about this story of these illegal religious communities. And that's the most radical. All those guys that actually perform some kind of terrorist activity in Bosnia and Herzegovina were part of that mosque. And nobody is mentioning that.
Certainly the King Fahd Mosque doesn't welcome scrutiny. We were some distance away because of a sign at the entrance banning filming. Just a few moments after the call to prayer began, the police arrived.
King Fahd guys were calling because they saw us filming, so I said, we are doing nothing wrong.
Yeah.
What you can do, you can write our names and let it be, let us be.
I'm sorry. So. Sorry. Yesterday we were talking to the foreign relations guy in charge of the Islamic Council, and we, you know, were told that there's absolutely no problem, they can be perfectly open about it, so what's the problem?
Via text messages, we complained about our half-hour encounter with the police to Cholic at the Islamic Community, who, despite his position, had been unable to allow us to film inside the mosque. He dismissed our complaints and also rejected the concerns of the former intelligence agent.
I simply don't agree with the officer.
So what is the sort of message that's coming out of those mosques then?
I don't know that we don't have that. The message is...
Do you monitor the mosques?
Sorry?
Do you monitor the mosques to hear what they're saying?
Yes.
How frequently do you do that?
On a daily basis, because we have five times a day prayer. There are imams, or three of them are there.
Late last month, Margaret Cormack, the piano-playing US ambassador, hosted CIA Director John Brennan when he made a surprise visit to Sarajevo to discuss the country's counter-terrorism efforts. Ambassador Cormack regards the Bosnian Islamic Community as a crucial partner in the battle against radicalization. But she had a clear message for Muslim nations and their vested interests.
We need these countries to allow Bosnia and Herzegovina to maintain its traditional moderate version of Islam.
Given the uncertainty about which Muslims potentially pose the greatest risk, can she be certain that the US and its allies are getting the right information from Sarajevo?
Certainly all of the U.S. security teams who either work inside of our embassy or have visited from Washington feel that we have a really positive, open information sharing with our colleagues, our counterparts in Bosnia and Herzegovina. We do not have the sense that there are blockages in that. What we have worked with them on is establishing better information sharing between the services here in the country, and I think that they are making progress in that regard as well.
Analysts like Dino Abazovic, a specialist in conflict and its aftermath, are certain that poverty is also a precursor for radicalization.
The number of, in particular, youngsters, younger generations, are seeing no future in a way of their prospects for employment and all these things. More than 40% of Bosnia population is officially unemployed. In that respect, I would say, is a kind of the circumstances that fertilizing a fertile ground for different kind of radicalization. So unfortunately, anyone who neglects social and economic situations these people are living in, I think is wrong.
Bosnia's enduring economic crisis requires members of the country's top rock band, Convoy, to take second jobs to support their music careers. They are advocates for the ideal of Sarajevo as a multicultural city and are horrified by increasing international hostility towards Muslims.
It's pretty, wow, what's happening now in the world?
I've been with these people all of my life. My best friend is a Muslim. He was the best man at my wedding. I was the best man at his wedding. My parents told me not to divide people according to nationality or ethnic. People here are normal. I think that's kind of media stuff that is pumping the whole the situation in Bosnia.
International officials are convinced that Bosnia's European, westernized, moderate Muslims are the best possible bulwark against radicalization. But in a country awash with weapons left over from the war, the need for enhanced vigilance is paramount. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Malcolm Brabant in Sarajevo.